Hello everybody, it's Adam from Lucid Pixel, and welcome to my review of Doom Eternal, the art of course, being an art channel. A little disclaimer here, if you have a heart condition, if you have anxiety issues, there should be a Surgeon General warning on the cover of this book. There might be, I don't know. I know there's an epilepsy warning as far as that goes. When I finally killed the final boss in this game, my experience, well, for starters, I think my daughter did shot a video on her iPhone of me going like that, just this hyper intense moment. I'm sweating, but when I finally killed him, I was like, Jesus, I threw my headset down, I put my remote down, I went, oh my God. It has gotta be the most nerve-wracking, intense experience in a video game I've ever experienced. A hell of a lot of fun, but I don't think I can manage longer than 30 minute stints at a time, because it literally, you'll be breaking a sweat as far as that goes. And what really blew me away when I broke this book open for the first time, well, let's break it open, is number one, the quality of the book, the spine, the nice sturdy, everything is really nicely crafted in this book, is how much traditional art has been used in it. Of course, bad example, now we're looking at a 3D model. But when you break into the book and you start seeing the concept art and illustration, how much of this is all done by hand? These are all hand-drawn traditional pieces of art, which is not to hate on photo bashing or the use of 3D. I have absolutely no qualms with that whatsoever. If it helps your workflow, that's perfectly cool. But there's a very heavy use. There's a lot of really nice traditional artwork. So it really kind of brings you back to the roots, like this kind of stuff, brings you back to the roots of just working in a studio, being an artist, designing these things from scratch. So as we start to flip through here, there are examples. They show the final work and how it's modeled in 3D. Gorgeous models. But look at how much of this is done strictly by hand. And I find it really, not ironic, but interesting how, despite this being a first-person shooter game, the incredible amount of detail and craftsmanship and work that went into the design of these main characters, even though it's a game that's heavily gameplay oriented, not so much cutscene oriented. So you get these little 5 second, you know, kind of silly evil monster cutscenes where they go, "You will not defeat us." And then of course you smear the floor with their brains, right? But there's not a lot of seeing the actual character or the enemies, the main enemies, that much, but that didn't stop them from going all out with the design. So right off the bat, my overlying thoughts on the designs themselves, this included, is just how much respect I have for the hard work and craftsmanship that went into designing this game. I can tell just by looking at it, it looks like the artists originally painted this in black and white and colorized it after, but quite successfully. Because very often you can give it a kind of like a bit of a markery type of synthetic color feel to it, but they didn't do that so much in this piece. They really pulled off the colors nicely. When you get into the actual graphic design, look at, again, all of these little subtleties that you take for granted. Doom Eternal, as you'll see, Doom in general, is a very good example of how much work goes in behind the scenes to create this sense of believability and immersiveness in the scene, to create this very visceral experience when you're playing it, when 90% of all the work that goes into designing this, both from a 2D and a 3D perspective, are very often overlooked. A good example of gear progression, really good example of this, how they use graphic design, these different design shapes, trying to see how they can kind of strike this balance between power, brutishness, not looking too noble, and standing outside from the design aesthetic that they use for the creature designs that we'll see moving forward. They even have their own language, their own alphabet, and look at the beautiful calligraphy that goes behind that. Why? For the same reason Tolkien did, just to add that extra layer of depth and believability to the overall story of it. This brings me back. Growing up as a kid, I was always a huge fan of these panels that were completely packed. I know Tyler for years has had this Diablo 3 screensaver wallpaper on his computer. It's kind of like splash page with all the characters and all this different stuff going on, and this really kind of takes me back. I get the sense of nostalgia being able to kind of enjoy this kind of old school style of art, and it has an old school look to it as well. Again, look at this traditionally drawn stuff, just redrawing different things and fleshing out different designs, all very handcrafted. And I'll give you this too. This is something else that I absolutely love as I flip through these creature design pages. One of the reasons I love creature design is because it's very often liberating. When you adhere strictly to human forms and human proportions, you have to be very anal about how you approach it, because slight off, like proportions or perspective that might be slightly off is immediately noticeable, not only to artistic friends, but to non-artistic friends who are checking out your designs. They'll see if the face looks a little wonky or stuff like that. But when you get into creature designs, you can start to integrate all kinds of cool stuff and have fun. And this, to me, is artists having fun. You know, it's kind of like just this kind of guy covered in tumors and all kinds of stuff and this twisted spine, and he's got propane tanks just infused into his skin. Like, the guy was basically with a welder's hat. Like, that's going to do any good for him, you know? But it's just this silly design, and just for the sake of having a creature that's gonna be blown to smithereens. Or here, just taking out the arms and having kind of like these pectoral designs, but the nice use of the hip, and all the leg anatomy is spot on, but getting playful with that. Taking something from anatomy, but breaking free from it to do something fun. When I did my Demons series of illustrations years ago on my channel, it had this same kind of feel and appeal to it. These guys who are designed to die, easy to kill. And what's cool about these is, as you progress through the game, they get a little bit more and more badass looking. So there's progression in armor design to show that kind of leveling up experience, but there's also progression in creature design. Starting subtle, building your way up to something more and more epic. Here's another thing. When you're drawing, one of the things that I found was kind of a little secret weapon to character and creature design is animating it. And I very often found when I'd have a character, I would kind of do this little panel where I draw them from different angles, jumping, sitting down, standing up, doing keyframes or breakdown frames and stuff like that. Not for the sake of animating it, for the sake of designing it. Because in movement, that can very often help you flesh out how these different things look. I find it a very powerful tool to do a little mini animation, rotating and moving things around and having them climb up a flight of stairs or picking things up off the ground. And just having these different panels and movement help to flesh out the design quite nicely. The other thing about Doom is that this is a sequel. And when you're doing a sequel, it gives artists the opportunity to be able to revisit old designs and upgrade them and improve them. And when you're sitting on a design for years, very often the artists who worked on the original Doom, who got rehired to work on this or flesh out some new designs, had a chance to be able to stare at their artwork for 4 or 5 years or more and imagine what it would be like to be able to build it. When you create a design, there's working, doing stuff for a studio, which kind of has, you have to kind of get it out quickly and get the ball rolling and stuff like that. So it doesn't necessarily give you a chance to evolve on a design. But that's why I strongly encourage my students, and I strongly encourage you too, if you're an artist who's developing his own style and his own brand, to hold on to ideas you have, redraw them, evolve them, improve them over the years. And that's where really good ideas come from. And furthermore, that's where a lot of growth comes from. It comes from starting with a certain spontaneous idea and then evolving it over the years, and seeing just how you can push a certain design. And the Gargoyles is a very good example of that. Here's another design tip. Limit the scope of your idea. If you're just doing a creature with a shield, then that's very general. And that can make it very hard to nail down something specific. But notice that this is a brutish, mace-holding creature of this size and this posture holding a big wall shield, okay? And just working within that very tight frame, working within that very tight idea, all of these very creative variations on this idea evolved. It's the limitation of the scope. It's saying draw specifically that, but play within those different parameters that allowed this artist to be very creative. This is probably one of my favorite pages in this entire book. As you start to evolve into the more noble, the more boss type creatures, notice how these creatures start to become a little bit more humanesque, less creature and brutish, and they start to get a little bit taller and have more humanoid designs. albeit in a very Dark Soulsian fashion, at least in these cases over here, hiding the eyes. So one of the things that I've always loved is having faceless enemies. Now, of course, these are kind of like godly creatures, these deities that the leaders of the creature race that threaten you, that you are weak, you are feeble, and they will get you. And of course, they don't. You kick their ass. But they take on a very human-esque, yet to take away that humanity, the facial expressions and the facial details are limited. Another thing that I appreciate is the varied styles in art. You can tell they employed many different artists with different approaches, but they kind of integrated them all into the work together. So this is, you can definitely see in this game how the directors respected the creative expression and freedom and the integrity of the individual artist and worked with that, very much in the vein of Disney. Walt Disney employed artists knowing that they all had very unique different approaches and styles and worked with that. He didn't expect everybody to conform to a set design. Just work within a philosophy, work within this ecosystem, but throw your own ideas on the table. Got to respect that. I like that in a director. Notice as we up the echelon, as we up the level of our enemies, they get more and more noble, more verticality, more use of golds and reds, these royal colors, these iconic golden colors, beautiful use of contrast and refined designs to give off a more refined and intellectual look compared to the very brutish, pulled apart type of creatures that just get torn apart. Beautiful use of verticality. They're even bringing in the whole religious aspect, the halos, the robes, iconic design philosophy, all within the Doom ecosystem. I love this design. It reminds me of a little bit of the Wet Nurse, where she kind of splayed out to create this kind of praying mantis type of big design. Very intimidating and scary, but lovely design. Beautiful golden wings. There's a student of mine who did a lot of artwork like this I really loved. Reminds me a lot of her work. The last thing I want to talk about is something I really have to tip my hat to the designers. What makes a game rich and immersive and engaging is not the superficial experience itself. It's all of the little nuances that very often go unseen. In audio, it's little cracks and squishes and scrapes and clangs and little distant sounds and little ambient nuances that you don't even know are going on that just create this rich experience. And when it comes to the design, there are so many things that you fly by. This is a very fast-paced game. You're just flying through this. But when you actually take a moment to step back and look at all the little tiny nuances in the designs, if I zoom in a little bit here, the fact that these old cars, they look like they've definitely been referenced from, you know, bomb zones, you know, the way cars get kind of destroyed and covered in gray soot after a bomb goes off or a missile attack or something like that. And the fact that everything is littered with skulls and bodies on pikes and all these little stringy bits and little and human beings that have all been hung and all these little tiny little design elements that you fly by at lightning speeds. And it's that which create this world that is believable and immersive. So as an artist, as a gamer, just enjoy. As an artist, take a moment to notice all of that hard work that these artists, these extremely talented artists, put into designing this incredibly iconic game. Not only for the stuff that jumps out at you, the stuff that you clap and cheer about, but all of those little nuances that they spend hours and hours and hours working on to create an environment that is a labor of love, quite frankly. And my hat goes off to all of you beautiful designers. I am a proud owner of this book. This is just a tease because it's a hefty book and my videos have to stay within, you know, legal time limits as far as that goes. But my love and respect to all of you wonderful designers and directors and sound designers and game designers and programmers that made a game that loads in 10 seconds. How the hell you pulled that off? And of course, if you want to pick up a copy of this book for yourself, I'll leave a link in the description below. Thank you for joining me, and I'll see you in my next book review. Take care.